we as individuals go through life and we don't even know about Dr. Day. And she is attacked by her colleagues. The press rarely allows her to be interviewed. They don't want her message out. And when I talked in the beginning about censorship, it concerned me. And I recognize that these are, quote, controversial subjects, yet she's just telling the truth. And she's not just an N of one, just her case. She is actually, over the last, what did she say, 25 years, now at the age of 82, she is taught and educated at so many different conferences. And I know there's examples of people who go, I just can't follow that. Even it was painful for her, but even her own brother, who ended up dying of cancer. And when she talks about, oh, you know, you hear people say, oh, meat is so tasty, it's so delectable. And when she talks about the fecal soup and 10% of the weight of that animal you're eating is feces. Do you want the feces well done, Danny, or do you want it raw or medium rare, right? What amount of feces is safe and healthy? Oh, people say, oh, but you know, you hear about plants not being washed and it's got a little salmonella. Once in a while, there's a spinach and an outbreak. Well, think about how often animal product and dairy, there's outbreaks, but they are legally allowed to have a certain percentage in that meat. In fact, the highest level of salmonella, the spirochetes, the bacillus bacteria, is present in animal product that we consume.
Well, as soon as an animal
that
dies,
you consume,
it starts to decompose and decay. And those natural bacteria, they're flourishing because that's the process for that to be recycled. But like she says, when you're ingesting that, it's decaying, it's putrefying as it goes through your system. And I mean, you know this, you could speak more to this than I, but you know, we're designed to run in an alkaline environment, right? Mm-hmm. Optimally, you know, our blood has got to be slightly alkaline or you're going to die. Now, carnivores, true carnivores, they have a more of an acidic system. Mm-hmm. They have a very short digestive
tract. And they have a short life.
Well, that's true too. Mm-hmm. But they have a very short digestive system too. Digestive tract, whereas ours is what, 30 plus
32 feet?
Yeah. So when that's coming into a human system and it's meant to be digesting fruits, vegetables, grains, you know, that are going to take longer to pass through and be absorbed, we're getting the adverse of that effect, you know, far longer.
Right. So what I've looked at, the practicality, and this is a special salad dressing. Can you make out what it says there? It's a little hard to read the read.
It's culinary zest, the new dressing.
Yeah, culinary zest. Yeah.
With a hint of sweetness and touch of spice to brighten your meals and your day.
Yeah, so you can use this on casseroles, on salads. I like to sprinkle a little bit on. It just adds flavor because, you know, vegetables and fruit, just like meat, you got to flavor it with something. People don't just eat wings without the hot wing sauce. Come on. So let's make the playing ground equal. Plus, the spices from peppers and chilies and things, these actually stimulate the immune system, particularly peppers. Peppers, when you read my earlier book, Grow Young and Slim, have like a huge percentage more vitamin C and nutrients. The hot red chili peppers, you mentioned the group, but they're loaded with nutrient density. And actually, people who eat more chilies around the world have a much lower incidence of lung pneumonia and infectious diseases. Much lower, because it stimulates the immune system. The little hairs in the lungs, the villi, and they move the mucus along. Have you ever noticed you eat something hot and chilly, you know, your nose starts going, and all the mucus comes up. That's a good thing.
Yep.
That's a good thing. It's cleansing. So I take this and I sprinkle some on, and we'll have some bowls after here. But this serving bowl is typically what I'll eat over a day or two. When most people say, I'm just going to get my little portion of salad and eat my main portion of meat. Mm-hmm. So the proportions, if you're going to at least start out with a huge portion, and we call it sequencing. If you want to really get lean and fit, as I get in better shape every year that people see me, they're like, how did you get in better shape this year than 10 years ago that you saw me? And I sequence. When I'm feeling that I'm getting a little too much calories, eating a little bit too much density, I start out with vegetables, fill up, salads, soup, right? Leek, potato soup. Potatoes are actually for weight loss, not weight gain. And leek is onions. They're great. And then And then if that doesn't fill me up, I go to fruit, which is also medium calorie, low calorie. And then I go to beans and peas. And then if I still have room, have a little bit of nuts and seeds. And if I still have room, I'll have, you know, kind of a variety of a mixture of casseroles and all these things. And by then I practice Hari Hashibu, where 80% you eat, you wait till you're satisfied and you go, okay, that was enough calories. I feel good versus everyone else. And if you still have room to fit in meat or dairy or chicken or fish, eat it at the end of sequencing. And I guarantee you, your health will improve dramatically just by doing that.
Well, into testing, experiment. I mean, that's, you know, I was raised by an engineer and a chemistry teacher and became an engineer myself. So, and in the investigation that I, you know, started to study nutrition to perform better as an athlete, right? But I got to a point where, okay, I'm getting all these different conflicting pieces of information. What makes the most sense? You teach intuitive eating, right? It's one of the things that I practice and work with my clients as well. I really believe innately we know what's best for us, but we've just got all these other layers of conditioning, of misinformation, of addictions, right? These patterns. And so, you know, the body has an incredible ability to heal itself. She mentioned it. We all have our different experiences and stories, but you've got to remove the stresses. There's the nutritional lifestyle stress, whatever it may be. You got to take that toxic load off that's keeping it, you know, pushed down, and then give it the resources it needs. And the body has amazing ability to heal.
Right.
I was a quadriplegic and I'm walking. Yeah. And nutrition was one of my absolute keys that helped me do that.
It's just amazing.
Right. You both have your stories.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Jenny, I mean, sometimes hearing it and emotionally living it and being around people who live this way, kind of finding your tribe, it's far more supportive, if you will, to do something where maybe one of the past offices you worked at or we worked at was like, the people weren't even doing it, you know, mm-hmm. and you could see it. You could see in how they looked and how often they got sick and everything. So you look at it and you go, okay, I want to be on the winning team. Personally, I want to perform better physically, emotionally, be happy and well. And how can you be happy and well and do good in your career if you're sick all the time, or you think you're healthy, but you're overweight, you're dragging, your energy isn't what it should be, and you're using a third grade fuel? Like, what do you mean third grade fuel? Protein and fat are the best source of fuel. That's ridiculous. We know that fat leaves a waste product of 7% fat, 7% waste product, which is highly toxic. She already mentioned ketones. It's just one of the toxins. Protein leaves 32% waste product, ammonia, uric acid, all these toxic chemicals. The body, the kidneys have to work overtime to get rid of. You're an athlete. Your jersey, if you were a heavy meat eater, it smelled like ammonia, right? At the end of practice.
True? I was eating cleaner than that, but, you know, definitely.
The athletes next to you.
I felt so much better when I've removed that from my diet.
Yes. Yeah. Carbs, guess what? There's not 30% waste product. There's not 7% like in fat. There's 0% waste product. Water, which you excrete, carbon dioxide, you exhale. It's 100% pure burning. So who in their right mind would want to put a cheap fuel in your nice car? No, you usually select the highest grade if you can afford it, right? The better the car, the higher the grade. The better the body, the higher the grade. Go to the highest fuel source and you'll perform better.